This is roll for sanity.
You cannot do that. You actually have to work as a group and try to accomplish goals. And hopefully whatever edges you picked out actually work together.
That's almost metagaming.
It totally takes you out of role-playing and immersion and puts you into a war game. It really does.
There's no chapter in the book on how to do that without the minis? They're an optional rule?
They did put it in. They said you don't have to, but it's not so hot. They said you don't
have to. I'll have to look up in the Sanity, too. I'm curious how Serenity does its combat, if it's like Traveler with the square grid thing and the 15 millimeter.
But the thing is that you're converting in your head, because, like I said, a lot of the combat edges seem to rely. You have to know how far you are away from things, and I guess you can do it all in your head, but you're doing a lot of this conversion in your head, and it's just a lot easier to have it on a map in front of you. Yeah.
Well, when you first explained it, I was thinking, oh, this is impossible to play in the brain. And then when you said that it's gaming, you mentioned the cards and you got the map, then it made sense what you were saying. Because you are playing a game.
I mean, don't get me wrong, it's fun and the players have fun. Yeah. But one of my frustrations with it was, you know, I'm like, we're playing a role-playing game and it's like, they're waiting for combat to come around because that's the most exciting part of the game.
Yeah,
because you're doing so much in that. There's whole much. Yeah. You're basically wargaming. So
that's what I liked about RuneQuest is that the combat, the D100 combat was amazing in RuneQuest back in the 80s.
It was second a lot of edition. Fun. It was pretty great.
Chaos. Let's make this big.
Oh, all right. 1889.
Space 1889 was one of my favorite games.
This is a great game, actually. Yeah.
Which one is this? The 86 one? The 87?
This is the very first taken off the hardcover.
The 89. Was it in the box?
This is the Heliograph reprint.
Yeah.
No, see, it was
it wasn't a box. I've got the original one. It was a hardback book.
Hardback. It wasn't in a box.
Nope.
It was very simple. All D6s.
Yep.
Yep.
I think it is actually, yeah.
And we used to use it as you would roll the 1D6 sometimes, or you would go ahead and roll, you know, the multiple, like the strength of four there. We would roll four six-sided dice against somebody else. We varied the rules in it, depending on what kind of a effect you wanted to have in the game. Yeah, but we had a lot of fun with it. It was one of my longest running games that I had, and it was pretty cool. It's very easy, very simple. Your wounds, it was kind of like Traveler. There's no kind of real level building in it. You just increase subtly, you know. So it's a pretty cool game. Very easy. Mm-hmm. Kind of reminds me of what you were talking about. What's his name? Total Party Skills there and his games. Yeah. It's very, very simple, very easy to use. And you know, you can generally take the base of this game, the mechanics, and make anything you really want out of it too.
Boy, look at those stat blocks. They look like Traveler stat blocks.
Yeah, exactly. They're small.
Yeah.
You know, you don't need much, you know, and that's the nice part about the whole thing is you make a monster. It's easy. You know, that's what I look for is it seems to grab. That's what gravitates it to me. So I just like having an easier time game mastering it. And we played this all Theater of the Mind. No problem. And it's got a lot of good background for the game. It's basically every kind of book you've read from what's his name? Conan Doyle or you know, everybody, Robert E. Howard.
Edgar. Rice Burroughs or something.
Jules Verne for the most part. Like when we played, I started with one player, and he played a British officer named Matthew Cross, and I had a kind of a love interest for him, which was Stephanie, Miss Stephanie. So Matthew Cross was ready for his engagement, and then he ended up being double crossed and hoodwacked by a French entrepreneur.
The damn French
who wore the powder poof wig and everything, and the white Casanova kind of powder cake on his for makeup, and Danton Mignon Monet was his name, and it was a blast. He was getting so mad at this character for infringing on his wedding day, and the chase went across the Atlantic all the way to South America, and that's where we introduced the new players, which were like, what is this game you're talking? And the one was Ted, who was my game master at the time, and he's like, I want to play something like Terence Hill. I said, okay, go ahead crank up your speed to 6 and do this and that. And there you go. And he was in his glory in that entire game. He was having such a blast. So we had Americans on the ship with the British officer, and they were always making fun of poor Matthew Cross in some way or another. But Cross endured it, and they went through all kinds of ruins in South America, they finally rescued Miss Stephanie. But what ended up happening was the game is actually still going on today. And I bought this game right when it came out and started playing it. Is this the game
your friend is still running?
He's still running it, man. Yeah.
That's nuts.
Yeah, he messaged me awesome. like yeah, 2 years ago. He's like, who's that guy that who's all the enemies that you were using? And I lined him up. You know, I said, okay, this is Danton Mignon Monet. He's this, and this. And it was like, okay. He's writing down all these notes. And so he's still running it. So it's pretty cool.
You know? How did die modifiers work in this game?
That's the thing is I was bringing it up to go ahead and take a look.
I used to have this game, but I think it was in a box, and I can never figure out how to play the game. I ended up giving it to someone else.
There was a set of airship rules in the box.
Yes, there's airship rules. Is
this the Frank Chadwick one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's see if we had.
I think I had a fan made something.
Yeah, one of these weekends.
Someone converted this to GURPS or something. I was playing that for a while.
They did this for Savage Worlds also. They actually made a new version of this.
Yeah, I should have bought that because it looked like a cool art book. Red Suns or something like that. Or Red Sands.
I think it's Red Sands, yeah.
Yeah.
The
artwork looked really cool.
Contents here. Combat, turn sequence, all that stuff. It's page 90, so let's go there. I like the big font, you know, the big numbers. You can read them.
So I'm curious what the difficulty level is that you have to roll, if there is one, or if you just roll under a stat.
Okay, let's go a melee attack. If a character is blocking a melee attack, okay, so the weapon's hit dice and required hit number. So blocking modifier of -2. Let's see if we can get into the mechanics, if there's more mechanics.
Or skill, is there a skill roll?
Yeah. Let's find the skill rolls and stuff. Turn sequence.
This is why I like Total Party Skills, because
it's
just a few pages.
Yeah.
The rules are just a few pages.
this is getting pretty, we're getting into ether.
But these are pretty, this book has pretty pictures. They want you to see all the pretty pictures.
Yeah.
Whereas Total Party Skills has no pictures.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of this is putting me on the spot because this is so it's been so long since I played this game, and I hadn't brought it out until I like, yeah, this was a game I loved to play.
The game reminded me of Beagle Brothers software.
Beagle for Brothers. The
Apple. That was a company in San Diego. I used to go by it was next to a game store I used to go to.
Yeah. Well, this is, you know, it's very old. There's, you know, it's in here, all the rules, except the thing is, you know, like old rules, skill explanations, all that stuff. You got to go through all, it all.
It's all over the place. Hidden. It's yeah, hidden in the verbiage through. Or the game master has yeah. to make it up.
It's not that hard to read through. It's fairly easy. Like it's not brutal to for you to understand. A good read through and you're like, okay, we can play this, no problem.
Yeah, that's how my favorite game in the 80s was Champions. And I wanted to play Champions with the Morrow Project. And those two game systems, you had to be an expert to know where a rule was in the book. Or this is before Post-it. They didn't have Post-it notes back then. So you had to use a lot of bookmarks to remember where stuff was in the book.